Welcome. It's my pleasure to share with you an idea that has taken root here at Stanford University over the recent years, the last 7 to 10 years, which has grown and grown to fruition to the point where I now believe we have a possibility of tackling one of mankind's most difficult diseases that has been most refractory to efforts to cure, and that I believe we have the possibility of making a fundamental difference of that in the coming years. You know, when I think about medical research, most medical research goes forward in small increments. The war on cancer, billions of dollars every year since the 1960s, and important discoveries have been made, but cancer remains a large killer today. I'm thinking more of an effort like overcoming smallpox, like overcoming polio, where a great deal of concentrated effort goes and gives us the ability to categorically overcome a major form of human suffering. You know, in the last 10 years, here at Stanford and elsewhere, but we have built the ability to regenerate tissues. But in particular, we have become quite advanced and very promising in our ability to regenerate the sound sensing apparatus of the inner ear. And the current state of the science and the technology is such that we are hopeful that in the coming decade that we will be able to launch the process by which a deaf child can be treated to restore the lost elements of the inner ear essential for hearing and to bring them to a normal life with hearing at a normal level. Helen Keller is someone who had a unique insight into what it's like to live life without senses. She was born with both blindness and deafness, but I find fascinating the insight she had about the impact of these two tragic losses on her life. She said, you know, blindness separates me from things, but deafness separates me from people. Indeed, when I think about hearing, it is essential to what is most elemental to humankind and to human society, and that is the ability to communicate with each other, to share our ideas, to share our emotions, to share our knowledge, to teach our young, to communicate with each other, to learn, and to join us together to common purpose. Unfortunately, hearing loss is a huge problem. 2 or 3 out of every 1,000 children today are born deaf. Millions of Americans, especially older Americans, become increasingly impaired with hearing as they grow older. In fact, well over 30 million Americans have impaired hearing. Now, in 2003, I was pleased to be able to come to Stanford to build a program. And in building this program, my philosophy was to bring together a group of the best and brightest scientists and clinicians from around the world to provide not only wonderful service to patients with hearing problems, but also to fundamentally change the research agenda in hearing with the goal of taking on the brass ring, taking on the possibility of curing deafness. Now, here's a beautiful drawing by a medical illustrator that works with us named Christine Greylop. And you'll see a number of these illustrations, which we produced mostly to communicate with you. This is a view of the organ of Corti and the hair cells. There are inner hair cells, which are the primary ones involved in hearing. And there are outer hair cells that modify the environment of the inner hair cells. What happens in hearing loss is that these hair cells become damaged, whether it's from loud noises, whether it's from the aging process, whether it is from toxic chemicals or medication, or simply a genetic defect where someone is born with a flawed inner ear. Now, why is it that we're so optimistic about the ability to regenerate the ear? This is a really key point. When you think about regeneration, it has reached maturity in the bone marrow. So when someone has leukemia, they can actually have an autogenous stem cell transplant now. On the other hand, in solid organs, if you have lost your liver, all you have left is a little scarred ball of connective tissue. There is no architecture. So you would first have to completely rebuild the architecture and then build the different cell types in it. By contrast, the inner ear with hearing loss has its architecture remaining. The elegant cochlear spiral still exists. The nerves within the inner ear are still played out like the keys in a piano. They still live. We know this from cochlear implants, which you'll hear later. We know that all we need to do is to replace this part, the organ of Corti, and the hair cells within it. And if we can do that, we will restore hearing. So it is a much more straightforward target in some ways than completely replacing most other solid organs. So based upon what we have learned through work in our lab and others, and also in the broader and robust field of regenerative medicine, is that there is no one unique pathway to success. What we propose is a 10-year effort where we have a series of different lanes, a number of different approaches. And in the first year and the second year, we will start out with many of them. And we'll see which ones begin to work best, whether it is through molecular modulation, whether it is through gene therapy, whether it is through reactivation of developmental master genes. We will try many different things. But as we find that certain approaches are doing better, we will concentrate our resources. So we set a timeline of 10 years. Not that we realistically expect to cure all deafness in 10 years, but there is poetry to the fact that we feel we can begin to cure deafness in 10 years. And then once that has been proven and we have in clinical trials methods to restore the lost inner ear, over the coming years, more and more, we hope to really achieve the goal, which for us is to make deafness gone as far away as polio is today, and to overcome this disease categorically so that no one has to suffer the isolation or limitations in their ability to enjoy communicating with their family and friends and coworkers. Thank you.